Good afternoon. Good afternoon. Welcome everybody online and here. And just for the people here, make sure you get your delicious lunch. We're making everyone online jealous. I'm Sarah Zanton, Dean of the Johns Hopkins School of Nursing. And thank you everyone in person and online for joining us for the third annual Lavinia Doc Lecture Series. We'll get to introducing you in just one second, but we're giving a plug for Lavinia Doc first. One of the pillars of our school's strategic plan is health policy and advocacy. And as I think you've heard from us recently, we want every nurse anywhere to know how to change whatever context they are in, their clinic, their hospital, their unit, their world, their state, their. And so we're implementing a lot of things in the curriculum and the policy honors program to enable our students to have those skills when they graduate. And Lavinia Doc was a social reformer and pioneer in nursing. She was assistant superintendent of the Johns Hopkins Hospital Training School for Nurses in the 1890s. And she was a provocative voice for nursing education, social reform, and the civil rights of women. Lavinia Doc believed, as we do, that we should all live in a just society in which all members are meaningfully equal and able to act on that equality. Doc authored one of the very first nursing textbooks, and she organized the NLN and the National Association of Colored Graduate Nurses. Doc was a brave and courageous voice who positioned nurses as scientists, experts, and social justice advocates. She took risks. In fact, I think she was arrested several times to vote. Yeah. And so I'm not, you know, go get arrested if you want, but you don't have to. She had a transformative mindset that we can still learn from today. So it's in that background that we are pleased to welcome Dr. Vincent Guilamo-Ramos as today's featured speaker. Dr. Ramos is one of my very favorite other deans. And he's a dean and distinguished professor of the Duke University School of Nursing and the university's vice chancellor for nursing affairs. Dr. Ramos is widely regarded as an expert scholar and leader in adolescent and young adult sexual and reproductive health. His research centers on the role of families in promoting health among Latinos and other underserved communities, with a special focus on preventing HIV/AIDS and sexually transmitted infections. He's founding director of Duke Center for Latino Adolescent and Family Health. He's the first male dean of the School of Nursing at Duke and first Latino dean at Duke. Throughout his career, Dr. Ramos has found ways to use nursing to fight disparities, push for social justice, and advocate for policies that improve the health of all communities. And we are so fortunate to have you with us today, and thank you for coming. And we'll have a time for questions and answers, and we'll have a microphone for the room, and then people on Zoom can just unmute and speak.
So good afternoon, everyone. It's quite an honor to be here. It always kind of gives me pause when folks introduce me because, to be honest, it overwhelms me. You know, I see myself as a man on a mission. I'm Vincent Ramos, and I care deeply about health equity. And I think that for me, it's an honor to be here today. And so thank you very much for the opportunity. I'm going to be actually not talking about my own research, but talking about some of the kind of thinking that I've been doing at Duke along with all of my colleagues and with the folks in my research group around social determinants. Some of you may have seen some of the lectures that I've been providing over the last 12 months, but I've been refining the ideas and they've gotten sharper and sharper, at least I think so. And so it'll be interesting to see what folks here think. And I'm really excited to be doing two things. One, I got a little bit of a history lesson because I didn't know, I'm sort of embarrassed to say this, I didn't know a lot about Lavinia Doc. And so in preparation for this lecture, I did do some homework and I learned lots of things that were unbelievable and very impressive. And that really gave me a sense of excitement and energy about the work that we're all doing today. I think in many ways, despite sometimes my thinking that, you know, maybe I have an idea that's innovative or maybe there's something that I've seen that's really exciting. The truth is, somebody else probably thought about it, did it, and really has paved the way for us. And I think Lavinia Dock is certainly one of those individuals. I want to talk about some thinking around addressing health inequities, and I'm calling it new approaches, but truthfully, I'm really referring to kind of what I was talking to Bob about this morning, that it's time for all of us in health, whether we be nurses or other kinds of healthcare providers, to think about a new way of addressing some of the challenges that we're facing as a country. I would say that what weighs the heaviest on my mind is really trying to figure out where we're headed as a planet and also as a country and in our local communities. And so I'm going to talk about that. So Lavinia Dock, I think Sarah Dean Zanton did a great job at really highlighting kind of her contributions. And so I won't repeat that, but there were a couple of things that really stood out to me, you know, a nurse scholar, a scientist, an educator, an advocate for important issues. Boy, does that really capture the profession of nursing. And I think it captures many of the people that are in this room and the contributions that we collectively have made. I think this history of nurse leadership grounded in social justice, that word, what an important word. And in many ways, I think Hopkins has been a pioneer, not only here, but on many issues in terms of really embracing and sort of manifesting what it means to sort of practice nursing with a social justice lens. At Duke, just about a week ago, we took a vote and our faculty has, we've redesigned our mission and we have a new mission that we're about to release. And I'm really excited to say that the word social justice is formally in the mission. And I'm really proud of that. And it only took us about 9 months to have really, really important conversations. And I don't mean that as a criticism. It's just a way of reflecting that we had a process, and that process was one that was sort of deeply meaningful for us. I think I am the third speaker, but there are two individuals that preceded me who I just wanted to acknowledge. I found these online. And so Drs. Zanton and Campbell, thank you for your contributions. You've been major figures in terms of nursing. And I think that you too also represent the best of Lavinia Dock. And I think in this room, there are many individuals who I would imagine could be doing this lecture. And so I appreciate having the time with you all today. So our profession, I think we're at a critical moment. And these are just a snapshot. I was upstairs in the Dean's conference room and I happened to go to the restroom, and on the little coffee table outside in the hallway is actually multiple copies of this AJPH special issue. And boy, is that an important issue, but not just the AJPH, the Future of Nursing Report, the new NINR strategic plan, as well as some of our recent national meetings. And there are many other things that we could put up that are good exemplars. But I think where we are is a growing recognition that we've got to build on our history and that we've got to do more to advance health, in particular health equity, and that context matters and that we need to more fully embrace that. I would say my own personal journey to nursing for some of you, it may be a surprise if you know my history that I actually am the dean of the Duke University School of Nursing. I didn't start off thinking that I was going to be a nurse. I actually started in social work. And so I was born in the Bronx. You can see me on the bottom left-hand side. I was a pretty handsome little guy there, right? And my mom in the 1970s and my brother on the right-hand side, and my mom is from Puerto Rico. And we were growing up in an enclave of the South Bronx and really happy about who we were as a Latino family and very proud of our community. Having said that, I didn't realize that there were things about our community that were quite different than other places in New York City that were just a few miles away. And to be honest, when I started to take sort of school buses to museums and to places in Manhattan, I started to imagine, well, why do people live in ways that are so different than our community? I'm being really honest here. I didn't really think anything was wrong or there were any challenges in my community because everybody kind of lived the same and we were pretty happy. But the truth is there were things in our environment that were shaping outcomes. And I didn't have a language for that, but I knew that I wanted to be part of a profession that was committed to notions of social justice. And social work captivated me because I was interested in helping individuals and groups and families that have fallen through the cracks. I was interested in taking a case to a larger cause. And that's sort of a fundamental tenet of social work, that you start with a person, but then how do you move that from that person to a broader cause? And I started to rethink things that I'd been sort of taught about, well, why are people poor and why do people find themselves in certain circumstances? And I really was drawn to notions of structural drivers and in particular poverty and systems of inequality. From there, I became really sort of enamored with public health and in particular epidemiology and pursued, a career in public health and starting to develop, community-based interventions that were focused on adolescent sexual and reproductive health. My area of practice is really unplanned pregnancies. I love, I'm not saying this to be flippant, but I love STIs. I love caring for people who are at risk or living with HIV. I do a lot of work around those issues, and I'm very proud of that work. And why I have gravitated towards that area is because so many of the contextual issues, they kind of get manifested in kind of, if we think about HIV. I mean, HIV in many ways has been a phenomenal disease in that it really has galvanized the world to respond, and it has paved the way in many ways to show us what things might be like if we were to apply similar approaches across different health areas. So I lived in social welfare and public health for many years, probably for a couple of decades. And then I started to feel like I had a calling to sort of provide care directly to young people. And so nursing started to call me loud and clear. And I always had this sense that I wanted to be a nurse. It's not that I just thought about it later on. It was that I couldn't figure out how I could do it, where it fit, how I could go back to school. I had developed so much sort of strength in the areas that I was working. And after I was in my early 40s, and I was actually a full professor at the time, I went to nursing school. And I sat in class with folks that were much younger, and I had an amazing experience. And that helped me to accomplish one of my dreams, which was to work as a nurse practitioner at the Adolescent AIDS Program in New York City at Montefiore Medical Center. And that's where I was working, both between NYU as a faculty member and at Montefiore with young people just prior to moving down to Duke. My path did cross with Duke in that I did pursue my NP training at Duke in the HIV specialization. Had a terrific time, great program. I don't think Hopkins would accept me, so Duke accepted me. I'm teasing. And so, or else I might have considered coming here, but I can't say that definitively because there's probably folks listening from Duke. And so I will say both schools are exceptional and they're wonderful. And so for me, family and parent-based approaches to thinking about things, I was always interested in context, sexual health, mental health and substance use, and then nurse-led mitigation of harmful social determinants of health. That has really been where I've landed and where I feel like it makes sense. And so while this may sound like a pretty long sort of journey, for some it maybe comes together, for some maybe it doesn't come together, boy, do these three things fit for me. And they feel like that's the kind of nurse that I am. I'm proud of that. And I actually feel like that's the kind of dean that I am at Duke, and that I'm trying to help the school to have dialogues about nursing's interface, not only within nursing and health, but within issues of social welfare and public health broadly. So hopefully you guys found that interesting. If not, I think my mom was a pretty attractive woman in the 70s, and she might be listening today. And so I kind of had to say that. And so she was a force in our lives and did an awful lot, considering, where we started. And so thanks, Mom. So I want to talk about this moment that we're in, and I'm going to do sort of an oversimplification here, but I think we're at a critical point. We all know that after, I guess, close to 40 years of increases in life expectancy, that we're seeing that there has been stagnation, and most recently there's been sort of a plummeting, a decline. Much of that is due to opioids, but also COVID. But I think it's an indicator that things are kind of going in the wrong direction. I think what's also striking, a number of people that I've met with today are working within chronic disease. And I think right now, roughly about half of all adult Americans have at least one chronic disease. And that proportion, that number is increasing. And I think that in my estimation, it means that we got to do something different. I'm going to keep on coming back to that. And so forgive me if I repeat it too much, but we've got to do something different. And in many ways, I think Hopkins is leading in terms of doing something different. One in 10 Americans are uninsured. One in five Americans are underinsured. You can see two in five American children are covered by a public option. You can see on the right-hand side of the slide what that means in terms of delayed care or did not get care. And so again, needing to think about doing something different. It's not just the sort of economic cost of inequities. Obviously, we're going to talk about that, but there's the human cost. And I think in nursing, this is something that I have appreciated so much about nursing, is this whole person contextualized perspective. It's the excess morbidity and premature mortality. It's also the unfulfilled human potential. I mean, that's huge, right? People not being able to be their best selves because of being limited by sort of chronic disease. It's erosion to social cohesion. You know, think about how increasingly we see that there are problems in communities around violence or greater tensions, divides. I mean, we are split on probably many issues in our country, more so than in my lifetime I've ever seen. And so that means that people who would have had conversations, connectivity, a sense of community are having less of that. Excessive bereavement, because of things like COVID or premature death. And then also, you know, for those of us that are interested in family approaches or caregivers, sort of unpaid sort of burdens being placed on families in particular, however we define those families, to care for people who have chronic diseases. And more we're seeing these things. It's not just financial, but it's also financial. In February, we're having at Duke a speaker. His name is Jay Bott. Some of you may know Jay Bott, but he works at the accounting firm Deloitte. And they wrote a paper in Deloitte Insights. Boy, was this an amazing paper, because they calculated what the actual cost of the health inequities mean for us today. And then also by 2040, what the cost will be. And this part, what was so fascinating about the paper, this is not the cost of healthcare. It was the cost of the preventable piece that if we did something different, we would not spend what you're seeing on this slide. And so right now the inequities today cost about $320 billion. By 2040, which is not that far off, it's gonna be closer to $1 trillion. And I think Jay Bott, who's a physician, but works now at Deloitte in their equity division, they're modeling the financial implications of our sort of continuing to do what we've done and that we need to think about doing something different. In my view, this is even more so important because of changing population demographics. You can see that the US is increasingly becoming more diverse. We know this. And we know that many of the kinds of conditions that lead to chronic disease and premature mortality are actually rooted in communities of color that experience a greater sort of adversity in terms of their living context. A good example is what I see, and I'm just using this, I'm being opportunistic, sort of what I saw in North Carolina, which really, it really gave me pause. I've got to be honest, I'm not somebody who often expresses my feelings, but I actually teared up in a meeting with the faculty, because I thought coming out of COVID, at the time I was living in New York City and I was living in the West Village and I was part of what was happening early on with COVID, I thought there were some real lessons that we had learned as a country. And I don't know why I thought that, but I thought some things had been made really apparent. Well, here's some data from North Carolina. Not picking on North Carolina, I would say that this is not only true of North Carolina, this is true of places across the US. And so you can see here that in North Carolina, that the burden of monkeypox cases was really experienced amongst African-American MSM, but you can see close to 70% of the cases were there. And yet, you know, most of the vaccines were going to white North Carolinians. And so big disconnect in terms of the allocation of resources and systematically creating over time a narrative that would be sort of something like this: monkeypox is a disease of Black MSM. And so I want to pause for a second, because we think we're seeing that in many places in our country. And I think part of what's been hard is that for some of us, we may then document the disparities and we may not be putting into context, certainly nobody in this room, but there are probably lots of people out there in the world, I'm certain of this, they're not putting into context, you know, why is it that we see these disparities and how do we then wind up reinforcing a deficiency perspective? And this was happening sort of literally after we were coming out of COVID, something that we could have done something different and prevented. I think it's not just COVID, it's not just monkeypox. in my lifetime, I've not seen, this is probably my favorite slide in this presentation, as many large scale events or challenges. I mean, boy, together, we all as healthcare providers need to be thinking about the complexity of the care that we're providing. And I think, you know, certainly things like climate change or widening inequality, more people in poverty, housing instability, what's happening in sexual and reproductive health, the substance use sort of epidemic, not just opioids, but polysubstance use. I think migration, areas that are very close to my own work and what's happening at the US-Mexico border, we've got lots of things going on. And I think these things, they present challenges for us in terms of the people, the communities, and the systems that we work in. And yet, you know, we also know that much of what determines an outcome is rooted outside of the clinical work that we're doing. It's really rooted in the context in which people live. And so three important things that have come to mind when I think about these large-scale events. The first is that some of these events have created new unprecedented challenges, and that was really apparent in COVID. And you can see differentials between vaccinated and unvaccinated individuals. That was something that was, you know, really striking, and that was a new challenge that we had. Exposing the chronic inequities. This was something that, you know, I was happy about this. I felt like finally there is common knowledge in a language and sort of realization that what had been going on that many of us knew had been happening for a long time. People were talking about it. Our country seemed very interested in addressing it. And I think that really showing that there was a disproportionate impact on certain communities, and that time and time again, there were syndemic experiences that those communities were having. You know, my own community in the South Bronx, where I was born, was the area that had the highest number of cases, hospitalizations, and deaths, more so than any other part of New York City. If I showed you a map of other kinds of health and social welfare conditions, you would see that we could replace COVID with other kinds of indicators, and same thing is happening. So why is that? Is it the people there are just prone to illness or negative outcomes? We know that's not true, but if you look at our approach, one might imagine that that's the narrative, right? Because it doesn't mean that the system that we're actually leveraging is responding in ways that are sort of synonymous with what we understand is truly going on. The third are these synergistic effects, and I haven't really heard a lot about this, but I've seen that there is a worsening. You know, one large scale event interacts with things that were pre-existing, and then it gets worse. And so North Carolina, for example, was doing pretty well in terms of overdose deaths from opioids prior to COVID. Well, we've lost a lot of that traction. Things are not looking so great. And we're seeing that there are larger challenges than what even preceded. And I think there are a number of areas that probably we could point out that are good examples of this. All this to say that I'm excited to be a dean of a school of nursing right now. I'm excited to have great colleagues that are also leading fantastic institutions, because I think we know that we've got to do something different. And we've got to kind of focus on a new way of trying to provide health to our country that is not just repeating more of the same. What we have done in the past, there's been a lot that's been great about that, but certainly there's a lot that we should be concerned about. So some new approaches. So like a good researcher, a good student, a good kind of thinker, a nurse, I started to look at, well, what's been written about social determinants of health. And I thought I understood SDOH. I thought that I had a good handle on it, but I didn't have sort of a comprehensive systematic view of it. And so I started to look at the literature with my team. And we found that in 1961 in the American Journal of Public Health, how fitting that there's a special issue of nurses that kind of focus on that today. But in 1961, the first paper that I could find that mentioned in the title and the substantive body of the work was on social determinants of health. Fast forward to about 2010, you can see that there wasn't a lot of traction. Things were not really picking up. In 2010, it looks like there was a blip, and you can see that there were 164 results that were identified. And certainly in 2022, you can see there's been a lot more interest here. And so in my review of the literature, I really looked at 2010 to 2022. And I really zoomed in on that because a lot of the thinking really advanced at that time. So the first thing that I realized was that there's been a conceptual evolution. And so I'm going to present a couple of different sort of frameworks that are just a way of capturing what I learned in that sort of big review. So the first is at one time there was recognition that social determinants of health mattered, but it was pretty clear that, and that they matter for disparities, but it was pretty clear that there wasn't consideration of any mechanisms. And so what you would hear are things like, you know, people have housing instability and therefore some outcome, some negative health outcome. But how that really happened, what the path was not so clear. We also know that in sort of the next step in this evolution was an understanding of two ideas that really emerged, this notion of vulnerability. I'm certainly guilty in the sort of more than 20 years that I've been a professor. I've had many courses that I entitled Vulnerable Populations, Working with Vulnerable Groups, Vulnerable Families. And I started to get really interested in, well, why are we calling people vulnerable? And if we were to not use that term, could we really specify exactly what makes them vulnerable? And would that maybe lend to an opportunity for us to actually do something? Because I'm not sure what to do about vulnerable individuals or populations. I think also there was this idea that there wasn't just an outcome, but there was a disparity, and that these were, you know, systematic differences in groups that were clustered. The third thing that I saw was really this notion of health inequity, and that there were social processes that were unfair, unjust, and that were sort of driving what was happening in terms of individuals, you know, families, communities. And so I think here, hopefully you guys are following kind of my logic. I don't know if I've done a good job with this, but I think it has certainly evolved. Much credit to people that came before all of us who really started to make relationships between these what could be described as static social determinant factors on health outcomes, this idea of systematic disparities and vulnerable communities, and then the formal introduction of this idea of social processes that are unjust or unfair. That's kind of where we are now. To be perfectly honest, when I look at the major programmatic sort of policy and practice, you know, ways that we as a country, you know, approach social determinants of health, I would argue that the universities and the scholars are much more advanced in our collective thinking than what we actually do in applied practice. And then what we see in applied practice is usually a figure, like if you look at Healthy People 2030, it's a figure with maybe five or six different social determinants. And the argument is that we've got to do something about these to improve outcomes. But what exactly are we going to do? And how can we do that? And what are those mechanisms? And in my mind, there were some important constructs that were missing. Some of these were actually in the literature, and they actually were scholars that were identifying these, but they weren't getting a lot of traction. So one of the things that was in the literature was really challenging this idea of vulnerability and talking about people being exposed. So there were certain kinds of behavioral and other kinds of exposures that lended to people acquiring that, whatever that risk or that protective factor is. Susceptibility being a biological thing, and really that there are biological reasons why people might be more or less susceptible to a given outcome. Social processes increasingly became important, things like racism, homophobia, et cetera. And then also almost never mentioned, but I think there is a group of scholars out there that are really advocating for this, and I'm one of those people, is really resilience. And are there solutions? Actually, Bob brought this up today in our one-on-one. Bob, you mentioned to me, and I completely agreed, are there things that are happening in the community that actually are a blueprint for ways that we might adopt those practices, and that we, and not to romanticize adversity, but people do thrive in spite of adversity. You know, there are not lessons that we should take away from that. And can they be part of our nursing interventions, whether they be in our research, our practice, our education? Should we teach also about ways of bolstering resilience and not solely at the individual level? So that long systematic literature review resulted in these eight principles. And I'm going to very quickly go through these eight principles, but I think in many ways, this is a good summary. If you want to save yourselves the, I don't know, 17,000 or whatever the article number was that was on that slide, it kind of boils down to these eight principles. And I think they're really important. And I'm actually about in a couple of weeks going to release them on a site through Doosan, where they all will live. And it's something called the Doosan Trailblazer. And I'll talk about that a little bit later today. And so I'm gonna quickly go through these, but I will say that this is just a way of crediting the many scholars that have done amazing, prolific work that have preceded all of us that have been really important. So the first is really, underlining causes beyond individual factors. And there was certainly a part of the literature that emphasize the fundamental causes. And in this work, distal factors or exposures really influence individual risk. These were considered fundamental causes. And it was important because it was important to try to mitigate health outcomes through disrupting these things that are sort of more distal. And so that was definitely one of the themes that was in the literature. Another is that context matters. I think we know that, but I think again, that risk is produced not only in individuals, but it's in context. And so I love this kind of image of the sharks in the pool, because one of the ones that I use a lot are two swimming pools that have a different number of sharks. And imagine that we each have to swim and we got randomly assigned to one of those pools. Well, some of us would have pools with fewer sharks, but we're both going to swim, or all of us are going to swim, but it matters the context in which that swimming occurs. It also matters once you're in the pool and you get bitten, how long does it take for a response? And how long do you kind of dwindle in the water with a limited response? And so the physical environment, the social environment, the economic and the policy environment, all of these things were part of the environment and that they shape sort of protection or risk. This is the tale of two communities. This is kind of what I was just saying. And I think one of the things that I've used in my own teaching is I usually will assign students to community A or B at the beginning of class, and they don't really know what that means, but then they have to develop the course from the point of view of community A or B, which I think is a pretty cool way of doing it. It's random. It's really random. The risk environment framework is another way of thinking about it, that it's not deterministic. Just because you grow up in a context of adversity doesn't mean that every person that has that particular experience will result in the same negative outcome, and that there are things that we can do in terms of our institutions, our healthcare systems, schools, other kinds of services, families, and then also policies that can actually mitigate things that may be contextually driven in the wrong direction. And so it's not enough to simply say disadvantage or a negative outcome is innate to that particular context. You can see that here, again, the two swimmers. You guys are probably picking up that I like this idea of the sharks and the swimmers at the pools. I like water. And so you can see that these two communities have the same prevalence of an STI or HIV, but you can see that in one community, there are some health services. And in both communities, they're swimming. The behavior may be slightly different, but what's really interesting is that because of the lifeguard and the medical care that's in that top community, you can have actually a very different outcome, even though the context is the same. And so again, it's just a reminder that there are multiple places that we can intervene. We know that it accumulates over the life course and that it does matter. Part of the reason why I love the second decade of life, I really enjoy working with adolescents, is because so much of what has happened in the first 10 years of life can actually be undone in that 10 to 20 year period in terms of, you know, many of the negative experiences. And so it doesn't mean that all of us can't change over time, but it is true that there is a particular cumulative impact of the adversity and these negative harmful social determinants on our health and well-being. Biological embedding, boy, is this an important concept. It's not just perception, right? The social is the physical, and that we know that there are changes in epigenetic and neurodevelopmental, immune, endocrine microbiome that all come from these negative experiences that communities, that individuals, that certain groups face in society, and that really, these social negative experiences that get manifested in the physiology as people. And we can track that. And I would argue that we need to spend more time in nursing, understanding these early indicators and intervening early on before people develop the kinds of conditions that we're grappling with based on what I shared earlier today. You know, families, you can see here that family context, that's certainly the context that I have spent my entire career, important because of the transmission from parent to child or within one particular household, multi-generational families, and the idea that, that entire family is grappling with whatever that social determinant is, or there can be different generations where the experience happens to one, but then it gets transmitted. And these are the multiple pathways that sort of biosocial inheritance and the idea that families is an important context for us. This idea of syndemics and that these things cluster, no surprise that in the community where COVID cases were the greatest, hospitalizations and death, that's also the community where overdose deaths are the greatest, where unplanned pregnancy, STIs, hypertension, depression, I can keep on going. I think you guys kind of get the sort of message. And so that things have a way of relating and that they can interact, and there's some dependencies there. And you can see the biological synergism and then also the socio-contextual synergism. And so really SDOH operates both through the sort of social and also the biological. And then the eco-social framework that has to do with the idea of our positioning and that social injustices, structural racism, that they shape health outcomes, and that SDOH is really part of that. These processes matter, and that based on our position, unjust, unfair, social processes, that we see health inequities. So all of this comes together. I'm sorry I did that very quickly, but I've written a paper about this, and once it's out, I will share it with you guys. It goes into it in much greater detail and reviews the literature for each one of these principles and makes applications to what I think is the path forward. But all this together, how do we make sense of this? So here we are at Duke, and there's a group of us thinking about, how do we take these principles? How do we take the missing elements, and how do we integrate that into something that we think can be an applied framework for nursing science, for education, and for practice? And so here's our thinking. And so I'll review this very quickly. And so we think that it's important to not only focus on one particular health inequity or outcome in isolation. We recognize there's a spatial temporal context and that there is co-occurring health inequities. And so it's important. One of our principles, and so the little floaters, which I like a lot, those are the principles that are now being applied to the model. And it's the idea that we know that these things cluster together. Vulnerability is a term that we don't like, we don't use, we don't want to use. And so we're really replacing that with really exposure and susceptibility. And one ask that I would request kind of humbly, if you guys would consider this, is if we could please consider not using the word vulnerable. I don't think the communities that many of us come from or many of us may have strong ties to, I think we think of ourselves as survivors and that we need assistance and support, but we also can contribute. And we have actual solutions to things that I think the rest of the world is grappling with. And so how are we exposed, and how do we become susceptible, and how do we actually reduce exposures to harmful things and bolster biological sort of protection? A great example is like, you know, the monkeypox example, right? And how that's going to spread in certain communities with a lack of vaccine to those communities versus communities where they have more protection. The floaters, again, showing the principles landing on those particular pathways. I think this idea of these broad static domains, housing, you know, income, education, really thinking about that. And are there some different classes or different types of influence? And one of them has to do with things that do represent a kind of capital. And so obviously your income or your housing do matter. But how do we start to think about some of the social processes that are operating, and how do we formally integrate them into the model? And so we've broken that up into some of these things that are more static, but then also the processes that are guiding a lot of our lived experiences and what people are experiencing. We also think of the model is happening at different levels. It's a multi-level kind of framework, not just at the individual level, but through institutions. And that's kind of what's happening on the vertical axis. You can see the meso, the macro. Resilience is represented because we, as I mentioned previously, think that there's a science of how people thrive, and it's worth exploring that and thinking about how to leverage it. You can see the life course perspective, this idea that things are cumulative, and the family is at the very top as an important context. This is a lot of how we're thinking at Duke about how we're going to sort of mitigate effectively the harmful effects of SDOH. And I think what we're talking about as a school is how do we develop interventions and projects that will target different points that are depicted here, whether they be at the micro, the meso, the macro. They may focus on resilience. Some of our faculty may just work in the susceptibility area and sort of biology, but all of it comes together to think about effective mitigation of the harmful effects of SDOH. And so really, really, really excited about that. And hopefully you guys see something of value here, because it certainly took us a long time in terms of thinking it through. And so the more floaters, it's just the principles coming together. And you can see here that they're just highlighting the ones that I've talked about. But it's showing how those eight principles that were reflected in that big literature review are now being expressed in what is on this final slide that shows the model. So what does that mean? So at Duke, we're really sort of amping up on our nurse-led models of care. We are very interested as a school in rethinking how we deliver care, both inside and outside of traditional healthcare settings. And how do we think about sort of new roles for nurses? You know, this is Miguel. Miguel is a nurse. He works on actually my project. I have a Radix Up initiative. I don't know if anybody in the School of Nursing here is working on Radix Up. It sounds like some folks are. But what's really nice about this project is that this is in the South Bronx, the community where I was from. And what's amazing about this is that it was really the nurses on this Radix Up initiative that went into the homes, did testing and vaccine uptake and delivery, as well as sort of management of chronic disease, very much like in the sort of capable and other kinds of family-based programs. But it was intuitive for us to think, how do we leverage our paradigm to try to make a difference in real people's lives? They were in close proximity to a major academic health center, and yet the people that lived in these housing products were not going. And so what we did is that we compared, and we're currently finishing up the RCT, the control condition was the standard healthcare system, what was being offered by the DOH and by the hospital that's a couple of blocks away, versus our nurse-led model. The school probably has now, I'm going to guess, about 11 or 12 such models that we're putting together across different areas. And we're trying to think about the entire care continuum and how we can then develop programs that will potentially mean something more than discrete projects. And how do we come together and say, hey, wait a minute, as nurses, we have something that is unbelievable and is amazing. I think that I mentioned earlier that we built this website that's called the Doosan Trailblazer, and it has three phases. The first phase is gonna be sort of released in a couple of weeks. And it really has, it does a much better job than I did in the 20 minutes that I've been speaking about the model. It explains all of the principles. It explains, kind of everything that I've talked about in a really elegant way. There's an animation and there's some voiceovers that are going to be there that kind of tell the story. And I think we have an eye towards it being a toolkit and that it will have downloadable tools and things. We're interested in really advancing our collective thinking. And we would love to get any feedback as we sort of release different parts of the Trailblazer from our colleagues and from folks around the country. Phase two is gonna be sort of Doosan models in action. We're gonna be highlighting those 11 or 12 programs and how they're actually mitigating the harmful effects of SDOH in different contexts. And then phase three is gonna be the business case. We're taking on kind of Medicaid transformation, and we're looking at Medicaid as one context where we think there's more that nurses can do. And we're sort of working with MNOT. I don't know if you guys know MNOT, but the sort of big policy group on ways that we can better leverage Medicaid for nurses. Products that we're proud of, we're sharing that because we would love folks to join us in thinking about ways that we can collectively, this was also a part of my conversation this morning with some colleagues, how can we collectively work together so that it's not just a given school, but it's really all of us that are in a position that we can really leverage making a bigger impact on health. I looked at the website here. I'm not gonna do justice to this, so forgive me if I'm leaving anybody out, but just a couple of examples. And I was sort of curious, you know, it's good form to A, learn about Lavinia Doc before you come and give a lecture, B, look at the yes, Google people and look at examples of things in the school. So these were just things that stood out to me. Doesn't mean that I captured the breadth and depth of the school. So forgive me if I've left someone off, but I think obviously Capable, boy, what an intervention, amazing national scale, tons of recognition, amazing example of a nurse, in my view, a nurse-led model of care. I think the checkup, cervical cancer, minority women with HIV, I also found this. Is this Dr. Rahan? Dr. Rahan, is that correct? Dr. Han, okay, Dr. Han. And so amazing, program as well. Jason Farley, one of kind of my idols when I was a registered nurse thinking about becoming an NP, I met Jason and he was doing this incredible work around PrEP. And then over time, I've noticed that he's done all this work in Africa around multi-resistant TB and these amazing nurse-led models, incredible work. Just some examples. This is exciting. So I'm following Sarah Zanson on Twitter. I see all of her tweets and I love them. And this came across as a tweet. And this is just really cool stuff. And so just wanted to acknowledge it because ultimately this is where we need to be. We need to be shaping these larger systems. And kudos to Hopkins for actually doing this. And so I'm going to wrap up by saying thank you. I hope that was interesting, guys. I haven't left a lot of time for questions, but I'm happy to answer any. And I'm here for the remainder of the afternoon. So I'm happy to kind of talk to anybody who would like to talk. Thank you very much. I've actually opened up the chat as well, just in case anybody would like to ask a question or wants to raise their hand. So Dr. Campbell?
What is inspiring that you can?
Thank you.
Lots of really good ideas.
Your microphone.
There is going to be a question. So, as you know, I'm an alum of Duke, and there was a period of time, about 10 years, where I tried to pretend I had nothing to do with Duke for a variety of reasons.
Okay.
One of which, what happened to the School of Nursing was one, that baccalaureate program. But the other one was because of the lousy relationships with Durham. Mm-hmm. And I think about, we're in a similar kind of city with a lot of the same health inequities, justice inequities as Durham. And when you were thinking about, when you were talking about working together, mm-hmm. I was thinking about maybe we could think about a model of working in the community we share, mm-hmm. a rather traditional academic medical center. Mm-hmm. Like you have at Duke, and you know, some of those models of care, and also importantly of nursing science, mm-hmm. because I've been thinking about implementation science is one thing, not sure that's what nursing's wheelhouse strength is. Mm-hmm. It's more of a translational science. We're really translating all of the exciting new scientific discoveries mm-hmm. into practice, and we have a community that needs, you know, such mm-hmm. Addressing the structural racism, mm-hmm. such work on health inequities. I didn't know if you had any examples of what's happening with sure. Durham, Duke School of Nursing, and if we might work together.
Sure. So great question. So I'm going to try to answer. I heard a couple of things, Dr. Campbell. So I'm going to try to answer the first part and then the second part. So I think the piece about working together is, I think, kind of a no-brainer in my view. I think the world of the dean of the Johns Hopkins School of Nursing would love for Duke and for Hopkins to continue building what I think is a good relationship, and would look for all of us to come together and think about ways that we can advance our collective common purpose. So I think that's something that would be very open to. In terms of our relationship with Durham, you know, Durham is a very interesting place, and right outside of our doors, we've got this really affluent campus and a community that is struggling. And over time, because more and more people are moving to the Triangle area, people are being pushed out of Durham, and housing has gotten incredibly, if anyone's been in Durham lately, boy, apartments in downtown Durham are hitting over $1 million, and just things are changing. I am really proud that our chancellor, who I report to of the health system, Eugene Washington, he's our first African-American chancellor. And I'm not mentioning that solely because of identity politics. It's because he is somebody who, I was mentioning this earlier, who deeply believes in what he calls the third wave. If you Google his name, you'll see manuscripts that he's written in JAMA that are really focused on the people who are not coming through the doors of the health system. And what does that mean in terms of partnerships between the academic sort of health system and the community, and how can we leverage who we are as an institution to do better? At our school, we've had, like probably most places, and I love the school, some growing pains. And so let me tell you a little bit about some of our laundry that probably we would prefer to keep inside, but I'm gonna share it with you guys.
Yeah, share it.
We have been really accustomed to having projects. And so we have many projects that are exemplars of great things, but those projects don't always equal something that is a greater impact, a greater story, a greater value, a greater way of showing what nurses can do. And I think part of our discussions in the school and where we're moving is that we're really looking to have a demonstration project. And what our demonstration project will be is a community in North Carolina that we're going to make a commitment as a school from the point of view of our clinical training of our students, our research enterprise, how we're educating, everything, our practice for faculty. And we're going to partner with a community in order to change some high level indicators regarding health. And what we hope to do is build a story around that, to build an impact evaluation around that, to actually develop a communication strategy around that, to get a development strategy around that. You guys can see that we're trying to put a lot of things around what we see as an opportunity to have immediate use to our community and to show the value and the importance of what nursing can do. And so look out for that. I think that it's been hard because it means that we've got to come together and we've got to say, hey, I've been doing this project here. I've been doing this project there. I've been doing this over here. And how do those things sort of add to this larger collective mission or not? And I think there's growing interest in people saying, let's come up with a goal for our school. A big part of what we've also tried to do, and I want to be very sensitive when I say this, again, I have the deepest respect for my school. Less discussion about things like our ranking or accolades about who we are, our brand, and more discussion about the kinds of issues and challenges that real people are facing. And when we focus on that, it's a very different discussion about our role and how well we've done or not in terms of responding to our country's health. And when we have that kind of honesty, then people are good people in the school. And I believe there's tons of good people in the world and they want to do something. So the question becomes, how do we come together to do that? And so part of what's going to happen eventually with the Doosan Trailblazer is we're not ready for this yet. So you're getting a really pre view of this, but we're going to launch a demonstration. We're going to take on an issue and we're going to do that in North Carolina. And as a school, our students and faculty, we're all going to work on having that impact. And I'm excited about that because the reason why I became a dean was because I wanted to impact health. So hopefully that was an answer. Yeah, thanks.
Any other questions?
Oh, yeah. Thanks, Florentina. Hi.
Hi.
This is awesome. Thank you. I don't know who your graphic designer is, but I wish I could borrow them. Or are you just really good at PowerPoint? Either way. So my name's Nicole, and I work a lot in our pre-licensure program. It's a master's entry program. And you talked about the need to change the model, and looks like you're offering up these nurse-led models of care. For that to work, we have to have really good pre-service education. And you already mentioned a little bit about this, but I'm curious how specifically you are operationalizing getting students to come out with the kind of awareness that you alluded to during your presentation, despite the demand for content. And I'm just curious what that looks like as nitty gritty a detail as you can provide.
Sure. So I'm going to be really, really honest here, and you may be disappointed by this answer, but I think where we are as a school is that we've just worked very hard to think through what all this means. And so now comes the hard work of making sure that our framing of this lives and breathes in our academic programs and in our clinical enterprise and in our research. We're doing that work. We probably have about 2 more years of being able to really make sure that we're all reflecting and whatever it is that we do in the school, that these kinds of principles are reflected. So that's work that's ongoing. It took us about 8 or 9 months, and it may sound a little bit underwhelming to what I'm about to say, but it took us 8 or 9 months to really redo our mission statement and for everyone to be on board with what we now have, which includes social justice. I love the process. I think it's been transformative. It's way more important than the words on a page. I'm seeing in the school a kind of collective common purpose that is really exciting and makes me feel like really happy and proud to be part of the school. So give us a little bit of time. I think we need more time to sort of make it fill out throughout our school. We are pursuing some tough questions about launching a master's entry professional practice, a MEPPIN program. And I think for us, we would like to have some kind of specialization. And it might be that we focus on something like this. That will be determined by the faculty, but we're having those discussions. Yes.
Thank you so much for the talk and the conversation. Just two quick things. One is Gil G, who is a researcher in structural discrimination. He often says it's not the shark, it's the water. Mm-hmm. So similar yes, kind of thing. Yes. And that it's so hard to change because it's the water that we're all swimming in. The second thing, I think a lot about structural resilience. Mm-hmm. And on your slide, you had resilience down on the micro, like it's a person. But I think especially in nursing, we focus too much on, oh, if you take a deep breath,
yes,
or try to reduce yes. your own stress in some, yes. you know, microcosm way, but it's the societal structures and the community Absolutely. Structures that can lead to more of a structural resilience where individuals don't have to be as much, just suck it up and get through. And
Absolutely.
So just that's no. a comment.
So I think that's actually a great comment. And so forgive me, that's really just an issue of graphics because it is at all levels resilience. It's just positioned there, but actually institutions can bolster resilience in people. Policies can bolster resilience. And I think what it definitely is not is sort of the good sort of old American work ethic, sort of lift yourself up and do it on your own and just endure and push forward. It's not that. It's at how do we create resilience? Is there a science of that? And actually it can occur at any of those levels. And that's really what we're trying to convey. Yeah. So great observation. I think there was another, yes. Hi.
Hi. We actually crossed paths. I left Duke right as you were arriving. We exchanged some emails. My name is Eliana Perrin, and I came to Johns Hopkins right as you were coming to Duke. Sorry about that. Your work is wonderful, and I'm sure very, very welcome at Duke. I, building off of Dean Zanton's comments, I noticed that you didn't have an arrow going from health inequalities back to social determinants. And I have seen that happen so many times that when people end up in unequal situations of health, that actually furthers their social determinants. And I think that one of the things we do really well in nursing and medicine is try to break that equation from social determinants to health inequalities. We work on that a lot. But again, on that macro level of stopping the social determinants before they start. Yeah. What solutions do you propose from a nursing perspective? I'd be curious about that.
Sure. So I think I'm a little bit struck by the first part of your comment, because I think you're absolutely right that when people experience those negative health outcomes, that can also be a slippery slope towards worsening. Sort of near poor people can experience something and then they're suddenly plummeting, right? And so I think that is a line that we should definitely look at. So just want to say thank you, because I think that will help us.
I see this a lot. I'm in pediatrics, and I see this a lot, that when parents have to bring their kids to healthcare, you know, they lose their job because they don't have ability to be absent, and they lose their job, and then they lose their housing, and then they lose their food, et cetera, et cetera. So, yeah.
Yes. And I think the latter part of your question, I mean, to be honest, I think that it's just recognition that we need nurses in all different places, and that each one of those paths represents a kind of leverage point, and that what we don't want to do is only, and unfortunately, I don't want to beat up on healthcare systems, but too often what they want is somebody at the bedside who can provide sort of care. And we need some of us who will do that, but we need others of us to be doing change, or all of us to be doing change. I love what Sarah said, change irrespective of their context. How do you change the way things are happening on that floor? How do you change the institution? How do you advocate for a policy? How do you think about changing, you know, a program, whatever? And I think in my mind, the more that we can support nurses to pursue those kinds of career paths, I think we're gonna get there. I will say that we need to do, and I say this with a lot of respect and humility, we need to do a better job at elevating sort of our contributions to health. And what is it that we bring that is really driving the potential solution or the impact? You know, the other day I was sharing this with Anna and with Cheryl. The Board of Visitors was at Duke, and they were meeting with the school, with me and the School of Nursing team, and our executive vice president for finance. He runs the entire university's finances. He was from Hopkins, Daniel Innes. Some of you may know Daniel. He was invited to the meeting, and you know, he was presenting some of the new initiatives for the university. And one of the questions that came up from the BOV was, well, how does the School of Nursing benefit from that? And how does the School of Nursing contribute to that? And he said, you know, that's a great question, because in my mind, so much of what the School of Nursing has been is a success. There are many other squeaky wheels on campus. And in a way, even though I'm not really, this doesn't make a lot of sense, we focus primarily on some of those squeaky wheels and not on the School of Nursing. And I think that part of what I love hearing from the BOV, they can say these kinds of things because they give the school significant resources. And so they can say, well, you know, you might want to think about that, Daniel, because if the School of Nursing has been an exemplary place, perhaps there are solutions to the kinds of issues that you're facing other places in the School of Nursing. And like a light bulb went off in my head and I was like, that is it. That is amazing. And so I kept on coming back to that in the meeting. And when Daniel left, and he's very important in our system, he left and he said, you know, I hadn't really thought about that, but it's true. There may be solutions to issues that we're facing that actually nursing's got it right. And I think that's true of Hopkins. I think that's true of many schools of nursing.
We get the job done.
Do we get the job done?
Thank you, everyone, for coming. Thank you, Dean.
Thank you. Thank you.